So we're making tandoori lamb chops, which are lamb chops. Well, we're not going to do them in a tandoor oven, but traditionally these would be done in a tandoor oven.
Yeah.
They would get up to about 800 degrees. Okay. But what we're going to do, we've got a rack of lamb, which we've separated into individual chops. And we're marinating it in ginger, chili, garlic, and then a masala spice that I've just made up with things like coriander, cumin, turmeric, red chili powder, salt, sugar, and then yogurt and lemon juice. And we're going to let my lovely wife marinate that, massage that, because she's going to get medieval with it.
So why is Sybil doing this?
Because I've got a thing on my hand, and I don't want to get I don't want to get this on that, and I don't want to get that on this.
This I'm on that, massager. And that on this.
That on this, and this on this. But you've got to really massage it in. And this is a traditional way of tenderizing tougher cuts of meat. But this is a great way. You can do this under the broiler. Or you can do this, as I believe you're going to do, you're going to have the grill going. Mm-hmm. Really massage it into all the meat.
I shall.
So basically, it's a good opportunity to get medieval on it.
He's not shy to give you instructions
either.
No,
he's not.
No. Well, particularly when I've had to rescue our rings today. So now we can cover this in saran wrap, and we can just leave it out ready for the grill.
Oh, it would help if I had it the right way around, wouldn't it?
You can tell it's been a long book tour trip.
It's been a long book tour.
It has been.
How long have you been on the road now?
How long have we been on the road? About 6 weeks now, with cooking every day, and yesterday was our first day off. So that's ready for the grill.
So even you can have a master chef cooking in a kitchen like this, no problem.
This kitchen's fantastic compared to ours. Ours is so tiny.
Oh wait, I gotta say that. I gotta see that on a close up. What was that? What did you just say?
I said this kitchen's fantastic. You should see our tiny little kitchen in Los Angeles. It's about a quarter the size of this.
Wow.
It's not the size that matters. It's what you do with it.
And cut. So what are we making now?
We are making what I call LSD, our life-saving dal, which is actually the dish that saved my life, because it was the dish I was making the day that I decided to quit my job and go around the world.
Really?
It was. So it is life-saving dal. It's a lentil gravy, very traditional to our family, this particular version anyway. It's using red lentils, which we've got here. We've got some nice organic red lentils. Really low heat. That should be plenty for what we're cooking for tonight. As you can see, I take very specific measurements.
Very specific. That is exactly, I don't know.
But what I was doing was exactly this. My grandmother taught me that if you toss the lentils in a dry pan first, they will take on a little nuttiness. And I think scientifically, when I spoke name dropping to our mutual friend, Mr. Brown, when I was asking him about that, and he tried this recipe, he said that he does think it makes them more porous and they take up more of the flavors. So I'm just gonna softly sweat down these onions. And what you can see is there's lots of spices already in there. Some cloves, some cardamom, some cinnamon, some mustard seed, and some pepper. And that's to flavor the oil. So everything with Indian food, it's all about adding layers of flavor at the right time. So I season the oil, then it's the onions, and then all the time you're turning this. So this is what I was doing the night my life was saved, because I was stirring this. And while I was doing this, I was feeling in a very black mood, very black indeed. In fact, I found a notebook, and in the notebook I'd written all the things I wanted to do when I turned 40. And I'd done most of them. I'd had a suit made, I'd run a marathon, I'd had my teeth straightened. But at the bottom of the list, I'd written four words that just said, go everywhere, eat everything. And so I suddenly went, that sounds like a good idea. And because I was having such a horrible time, the next day I quit my job, and a few weeks later I was on a beach in Australia at the beginning of the journey that became my first book.
Wow.
And the journey when I met my beautiful wife, who's over there.
Sitting over there. Hi there, Sybil.
And that's what brought me to the United States and to this current journey that I'm undertaking now, which I have become, in fact, a United States citizen. So this dish is very important to me, not only because it comes from my family, but also because it saved my life. It is literally life-saving dal.
That's a great story.
And you can do this with chicken stock, you could do it with water, but we're going to do it with vegetable stock. So this is a purely vegetarian dish. And what else makes it special is that we cook it with lemons in. So we've washed this off just to make sure there was no wax on the outside.
Right.
And then what we're going to do is, you can see we've got pureed ginger, pureed garlic, pureed chilies. That's for another dish. So we're going to use some of that as the base, and then we're going to use some of my kind of all-purpose masala mix that I make up.
I wish there was smell-o-vision on this, because this does smell amazingly good.
And wait till it starts cooking. So you have to take your time with it, with this kind of dish.
I love that you talk about memories, because that to me is what food is all about. It always makes me think
about
my mom.
It's all about context. Yeah, it's about terroir. Yeah, mm-hmm. You know, when people talk about the terroir of food and wine and all of that, they're not just talking about the location, they're not just talking about the land, they're talking about the people. You know, you can taste wine made by certain winemakers, mm-hmm. certain distillers, you can taste. So you can see this is really getting nice and soft now. And the smell is incredible.
It is.
Onions and spices. But once this gets too hot to touch, then these mm-hmm. are ready to add to the dish. And there's one other essential ingredient for this.
Ah, yes.
I've got to be drinking a glass of wine, otherwise it doesn't taste right.
Ah.
It's true.
Yeah, so see, this is the true chef. You got the wine sitting right there, right next to what you're doing.
And you can see now these are softened up really beautifully. Mm. So now what we're going to do, now we've got it to this stage, our next ingredients, which is, this is just some fresh ginger that I've pureed up.
Okay.
We're going to add about just over a tablespoon of that. We're going to add a bit of the juice as well. And I think I want a bit more. And that, and the key is that you keep stirring. So this is just pureed garlic.
All right. Oh, look at that. Look how beautiful that is, huh? I'm
going to keep it a little bit back for another dish. I don't need too much for my next dish.
I'm going to get out of your way.
Just pop it out of the way. And this is key with any cooking.
Yeah,
this is called mise en place. Everything in its place.
Everything is prepped and ready to go. Look at that.
So if you put in the effort early to get everything ready, then the actual cooking side is fairly straightforward.
Right.
Oh, and if you smell that now.
Mm. Oh, wow. Yeah, we need smell-o-vision.
We definitely do.
We really need smell-o-vision. Okay.
And puree of serrano chilies. Now, the reason I puree everything is the more you reduce something in size, the more surface area it has, so the more oils it releases. So if you puree garlic, it releases a lot more of oils. You know, if you have a whole garlic, you've got a whole garlic head there, you roast it, it's going to be quite sweet.
Right.
But if you puree garlic, it's quite strong. So it just gives you a bit more control of the heat. And what I like to do is get all of this juice that comes out of it. Now, you don't need to add all of this. I just like this a little bit spicy. And you can already see it's
Oh, my God. This is so much fun. So what was the inspiration of Fed White and Blue?
Well, I decided when I moved here from England, which was a big move for me, to the continent, it's still quite, that I wanted to become an American citizen. I didn't just want to be, you know, a resident. I didn't want to just be a green card holder. I wanted to be able to vote. I wanted to be able to express an opinion. And I think unless you take a kind of meaningful part of that, then you don't really have that opportunity. And part of that for me was becoming an American citizen.
Okay.
So I asked America to invite me to come and share their food experiences because I thought that was the best way to find out what it meant to become one of you lot because you're all a bit nuts. Now we get to the fun part. We're adding some spices. And this is a spice mix I've just made up with turmeric, chili powder, cumin, coriander, salt, and sugar. So very simple one. But we're going to put in a fair bit here because I want quite a bit of spice and warmth through this. In all of these spices with this onion, and you're going to create almost what I call my curry jam.
Right.
And what you're going to do is you're going to, if you smell it now, it's very raw. It smells raw.
Oh, yeah.
Nice, but raw.
Okay.
So we're going to cook this down until it sweetens a little bit.
Good, come on over. So Heather's here, Randy's here, Quinn's here.
Hello.
It's a Simon.
Hello, Simon.
Simon is cooking in my kitchen.
She's having a gin and tonic.
There's usually a gin and tonic in front of Simon.
Yeah, there's usually alcohol involved once Simon starts cooking.
So you can see.
Look at that.
The oil's beginning to come out of it now. And I call this my onion jam. And what I do is I'll actually cook my curry jam. And I actually cook this up in big batches. And I keep it in the freezer because it's almost like a mother sauce.
Yeah.
So if you add yogurt to this and chicken, you can take it in one direction. If you add tomato, chopped tomatoes and shrimp, you can take it in another. If you add lots of lime juice or if you add heavy cream and pieces of tandoori chicken, you can make a chicken tikka masala. So it's a very kind of simple base. Just about too hot to touch, so that means I can turn.
Just doing it until it's too hot to touch, and then it's ready to go.
And then that's ready to go in here.
Dump it on in, huh?
So we can dump that on in there, and we'll just coat it. And this is almost the way I describe this, is a bit like when you put rice into a the base of a risotto.
Yeah.
You want to make sure that it's stirred and covered with all of those. You know, you would use onions and garlic and whatever you've got there. Same here.
Yeah.
So you just, but this is a vegetable stock, so this is going to be a purely vegetarian dish.
For my wife.
For your wife.
And my wife is a vegetarian.
But you could add chicken stock if you really wanted to give it some vegetable stock. Gives it great flavor. Now I'm not going to add it all in now, and then we're just going to let this simmer.
And we have a traditional Indian drink over here, apparently.
Gin and tonic.
Yes. Gin and tonic was created by the British in India to get the officers to drink tonic water, which had quinine in it. But being sensible men, they wouldn't have it without booze, so they poured gin in it. So it was gin and tonic.
Yay! Mm.
Okay. And the gimlet, which is a version of the martini that they had created by the Royal Navy, was to get the Royal Navy officers to take lime so they didn't get scurvy. So that's the origins of these dishes. This is the sauce for the chicken korma. So what we're doing in here, we've got almond flour, some spices, some just some chili powder, sugar, salt, and turmeric, some heavy cream, and then I've just put a whole lot of boiling water on there, about a cup of everything. And that boiling water brings out all the oils. I need to turn this down.
This is our
life-saving Daal coming together very nicely. That. We're making the base for my chicken korma. So we've got a similar base to this one, just because I'm using just for time. But the difference is that the onions for this were pureed, because I want this not to be chunky. I want this to be very kind of smooth. And now I'm about to use chicken thighs. Always chicken thighs.
Always chicken thighs.
Always chicken thighs. Speak to any chef and they'll always tell you they hate chicken breast. It has no flavor at all. So chicken thighs are your thing. That's where all the flavor, because you want a bit of fat on them as well. You notice I haven't trimmed off all the fat, because fat's where all the flavor is. So, and we're not going to brown this, and that's why I'm not too worried about the fact that the pan is a small pan, so it's a little bit overcrowded. Turn back the heat. And I always say to people, remember, ovens have got, you know, stoves have got controls for a reason. You're allowed to use them. You don't just have to always have it at one heat. So we're just going to stir this into this sauce, and we're going to cook it to about two-thirds of the way through, and then we're going to add that wonderful sauce that we made. So this same base that I've done with the chicken, that's going to be quite spicy. I hope people like that. You can also do with cauliflower. So you'll get that same onion, chili, ginger base, toss in some cauliflower florets, and then add the sauce, and then you've got a great vegetarian version, as long as they can eat dairy. In this instance, I used heavy cream, but if they can't eat dairy, you can use coconut milk. See, now we've got this to about the two-thirds stage. You can see it's seared on the outside. It's a little still pink there, but we don't want char, because this was supposed to be a royal dish. So this was supposed to be quite pale traditionally. It shouldn't even have the turmeric in it. It would just be cream and almonds. It's a Persian dish. And when they served it, they would even put layers of gold leaf on top. As they brought it to the table, they would throw gold leaf. So this was a very royal dish. And now you don't want to get too much color on it. And that's thickened up a little bit. You can see all the almonds and all the cream. And we're just going to put the rest of those almonds in.
Wow, Randy.
And this is actually even better. We're just going to let this poach away. So now the chicken's just going to poach in that sauce to finish off cooking.
Nice.
And it'll come back and it'll be very thick and creamy and delicious.
Wow.
And then before we serve it, we're just going to squeeze what we call the ignition key, lemon juice. So we squeeze that over it. Okay, so now we've got these lamb chops. I'm going to try and take off a little bit of the excess marinade. These have been marinating in yogurt and spices and chili and ginger and lime juice and a little bit of it. And we're just going to pop them on. And we don't want these overcooked. We're just going to cook these through to about medium rare. So about 3 minutes a side.
We've got the young apprentice here, Quinn. He's taking some pictures. He's watching. Yes. Yeah. Might as well, man.
I don't know how many times we'll get somebody like Simon to cook here at my house.
You keep building up all this pressure. Now we're going to need a platter to serve them on.
So my buddy Eric Addison out in San Diego actually owns this exact same grill, and we laugh all the time when we're grilling. So, you got any advice for Eric on how to make these lamb chops awesome?
Invite me over, pay me a great deal of money, and I'll come and cook them for you.
Wonderful.
I'm going to move them to the hotter part of the grill.
Okay, yeah. The right side of my grill is
much hotter.
Oh, and
you can already smell now.
Yeah.
Key with lamb. You want to get the marinade cooked, but you don't want to overcook the lamb. I still think it's got to be a little bit pink in the middle. It's lamb. I'm sure. Oh, that's what you're looking for.
That's beautiful.
That's your color. That beautiful golden color.
So this is normally I do this. This is Alton Brown shrimp cocktail, which he says to broil. I do them on the grill, but if you just cook them and eat them, they're fantastic. Just basically shrimp on the grill.
Got to love shrimp on the grill.
Yeah, well, who doesn't like shrimp
so
on the grill?
So I'm just getting some of these sides.
Look at that. Look how beautiful that is.
So you can tell
in the family.
With meat, if you squeeze it like this, you can probably see it this way, Quint. That's still too rare because it's still a bit squidgy. That's a technical term.
Squidgy.
So that means it's going to be too rare for some people. So I'm just going to cook that a bit more.
Right.
In fact, if you pass me that,
I will gladly pass you that.
I'm going to get these working while we're...
Yes. I'm cooking with Simon Majumdar. This is awesome. It actually really is. This is such a treat.
Oh, are you kidding?
Such a treat. I wish my wife was here. You just pop them off and you eat them and off you go. Or you make them in advance, you cool them off, and they're a shrimp cocktail.
I love that idea.
Yeah.
And you don't need to marinate them very long, do you? Because they're, you know, they're shrimp. It's otherwise they'd go mushy if you brine them for too long.
Oh, no!
Oh,
man. I don't know. What do you think? Can I save it?
Yeah, you can save that.
Ah! Dagnabbit. Ah! Oh, now that's why he is Simon.
Ooh. Asbestos hands. That's what we're looking
now
for.
Now, my grandmother could have just reached right in there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, now you see, that's the color we're looking for.
Now that.
Isn't that sexy?
That. That is television show worthy right there.
Up there.
Is it not?
Mommy, no wine for you.
Quinn's going, I don't know whether I want to eat it or take it to prom.
Right.
So now that's, now you can press that, that's going to be medium rare. And we
beautiful.
Want it probably just a little bit more to medium for my liking for this. Just for
gorgeous.
The your average.
This is the hottest spot on the grill.
Which
right
is
there.
What we want. See there, Quinn, mm-hmm. In you come. That's that little charred action. That's what we want. We want a little charry action.
As long as your ideas are delicious, we'll get along just fine.
Oh, yes.
How many relationships are built around food? How many deals are made around food? I mean, food
well, every
is so
good deal should be
lives,
made,
right?
Of course it is. I mean, look at this. It's
yeah.
Also, it's just fun. You know, I've been cooking on this trip with people who are so, you know, I'm a very left coast liberal,
yeah.
And yet I've been cooking with people who are, you know, very right wing, very religious, total
right.
Opposite of me. And yet, you know why we get on well? Because we're eating food and we're drinking wine.
Yeah. Look at that. So you've been staring at this. Look at it. Oh. See, now look at that. That's a beautiful little thing going on there.
That is some sexy stuff going on there.
Sexy.
All right, so here we've got our little shrimp cocktail. So we got Alton Brown shrimp cocktail. We got Simon Majumdar lamb?
Tandoori lamb chops.
Tandoori lamb chops. Oh, these are gorgeous, Simon.
They're all right.
They're all right.
They're good.
At them.
Even though I say so, I'd like to rest them a bit. We didn't have a chance to rest them.
They can rest.
All right, we're going to stop.
So I have two jokes that I'm going to share.
No!
So the first one is, of course, I'm not going to share the shrimp. You know why? I'm too shellfish. So I'm going to ask you a question, and when I ask you this question, you have to say yes, okay? So would you like to see the wine list?
Yes.
Wah, wah, wah. She's laughing. Oh, what's the sound of one hand clapping? All right, so how was the first course?
Amazing.
Awesome.
The lamb was just amazing.
And someone left the shrimp in front of me, so I'm still eating it.
Yes.
What do
you think, Quinn?
So
it was delicious.
I know.
I think my plate speaks for...
So there's the plate of Quinn that's basically done. Good stuff, huh?
Very good.
Chicken.
I'll get the. So this is for the chicken korma.
And that is on my grandmother's probably 70-year-old plate.
So I'm guessing this is the first time this plate has ever had chicken korma on it.
Probably.
That's okay. That's we just need a plate for the bread.
So pretty.
This is our life-saving Daal.
This is life-saving Daal. Toss that in. It's got a little, tiny bit of. I put a what's called a concasse, a little fine chop of tomato in there.
Okay. We'll get some bowls out for everybody.
Make a little bit of space.
The bowls are gone.
Yes. And then we'll just get the bread. A plate for the bread.
Wow.
But while you're doing that, I'm going to be just working on the crumble.
Why don't you eat with us?
I will. I've got to just get this. If we could get the oven on quiet.
What's the matter, babe? Molly, what? Is it time to make the crumble? Is it?
What did you make for me?
Yes.
I like Lambo.
Okay, she wants you to make the crumble.
Don't have it.
Do
you
have rice
already?
Yes,
we run
out of rice. Yeah,
quit hats.
You've got to eat it with your hands. If you don't eat it with your hands, then you're dead to me.
Oh!
There you go.
You've at least got to try. You've got to scoop it all up.
To give him a piece of bread, pass the piece of bread over to Quinn.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he wanted his rice before he wanted his bread, so.
There you go.
He loves his rice.
So now we got to eat it with our hands. We've got to try to eat it with your hands. So this is pretty much what Fed, White, and Blue is all about, just touring the country and enjoying food.
Sharing food with people, cooking for people.
Wow.
So who's your favorite Doctor Who?
Mine is, well, it would be between two who I remember. The first would be number three, John Pertwee, who was the dandy, and then Tom Baker, who was the genuine eccentric. And I think most people in the UK would look to Tom Baker probably as the favourite ever Doctor Who. He would be like the Sean Connery of Doctor Who.
If you compare, Sean Connery of Doctor Who,
if you compared it to James Bond, he's like everybody's favourite in the UK. But of the reboot, I think Matt Smith or David Tennant would probably be. People are still finding their way with Peter Capaldi. But don't forget, with Matt Smith, people weren't sure after the first season at all. They didn't know. And he turned out to be fantastic. And I think Peter Capaldi will. Because he's just very angry. And I like that. I like it. And he's just such a great actor.
Oh, you're taking care of my wife.
I'm taking care of your lovely wife,
who's not here.
By making that same base that we made before for the chicken.
Uh-huh.
Just turn this heat down a little, because we don't want to burn it. And now what we're going to do is, rather than chicken...
Cauliflower.
We're going to toss in some cauliflower. So if you notice, what we've done is we've steamed this cauliflower for about 10 minutes. So it's still, it's not cooked, but it's not raw. So it's about halfway. So this will just poach now. Like we did with the chicken, this is just going to poach in the cauliflower.
Look at that, that's gorgeous. That's done.
Cauliflower korma.
Nice.
Hope you enjoy, Rebecca.
Yeah.
Please bend over.
I've got.
Let's have a look. Let's see how we're doing. Oh, and that's how you can tell it's ready. See all the juices now bubbling out from the berries?
Yeah.
Right. The ice cream. But before we serve
that. Look at that. So that's for Quinn. What about the rest of us?
Just put that right here.
poor Molly knows there's none for her. She's not even looking.
So this is berries, and then it's peaches soaked in Cointreau.
I guess I could have brought the smaller bowl.
Peaches soaked in Cointreau.
Well, this or your vanilla?
I like kiwi. You don't mince it. Put a little kiwi thing in there.
It should be nice and juicy.
Yes.
And then the topping is just almonds.
I don't know about that. It's cool.
Oats, sugar, butter, a tiny bit of flour. I'm actually in a bit of a food coma right now, and I've hardly eaten anything. Have you eaten much?
Let's see. So we started out with crackers and some cheese. We had some nice roasted peppers that I made.
Fantastic roasted peppers.
I did up a little Alton Brown shrimp cocktail. You did up a whole ton of...
I'm not going to lie, did love AB shrimp. I thought they were fantastic. They've got a real bite to them when you brine them like that. I'm going to have to try that.
Yeah.
As ever, he's correct. But I think he would have enjoyed my lamb chops.
Oh my God, the lamb chops are... I'm always scared to make lamb. I really am. But watching him do it on the grill...
Hopefully you saw how easy it was.
You moved it around, because you know every grill has a hot spot, has a cold spot.
You've got to pay attention to them.
Yeah.
Until they get that nice little char, but they're still tender and juicy. Hopefully, shout out from the crowd. He said, were they juicy? That was fun.
That was
overdubbed. Who knew we could afford overdubs? And then what did we go on to? We had rice.
Rice.
With a pilau rice with a little bit of spices through it and a bit of butter.
That was nice.
Of course. Some
chicken.
Some chicken korma.
Right.
Which is chicken with made with almonds and cream, spices.
Really nice.
And hopefully nice and succulent.
It was succulent.
I love
word.
That word.
Succulent. It sounds like succubus. But
it sounds
succulent.
Almost like, yes, one of the villains in Star Wars. He was a succulent.
It was a succulent.
They were destroyed by the succulents.
Yes.
And then we had Daal.
Life-saving Daal.
We had life-saving Daal.
Kind of like James Daal and the Giant Peach.
Daal and the Giant Peach, yes.
Mm.
And then we had, what else did
we
have?
I have no idea where that came from.
No, I know. Well, then we had...
This is coffee. This is not alcohol.
I know, I'm drinking tea.
Yeah.
Because I'm English. And then we're having... Then we had pudding, as we say in England.
Mm,
you say
beautiful.
Dessert. In England we say pudding, which encompasses all desserts rather
really?
Than... In the US, when pudding, you mean something more like a custard.
Yeah.
Well, that's a very US use of the word pudding. Actually originates from the Romans. The word pudding means originally is the same word, comes from bilitus, that went in one direction and led to the sausages, and in another direction to the kind of steamed puddings that we have. So in England, pudding means anything that is a dessert.
You know, you can't have your pudding if you don't eat your meat.
There you go.
Yeah.
So we made crumble.
Crumble. Oh, amazing crumble.
Yes, so it was.
Some berries, some peaches, some Cointreau.
I would hesitate to say it was very good.
Oh, God.
You really should hesitate. Say that. Womp, womp, womp.
But we had it with some nice ice cream, and now we're having a nice cup of tea.
Oh, macadamia nut ice cream from our friend at Publix. Oh, my God.
And then we made a little cauliflower korma as a little extra for Rebecca. So it's been a lot of fun. Thank you, pal. Thank you for inviting us. We shall sleep well.
Fred White and Blue Tour, if we all haven't gone to see him yet, you're still going to be traveling for
like
the next 5 years.
I am
going to
be traveling around
years.
The country, it seems like that, for about, yes, until I'm an old man.
Yeah. No, Fred White and Blue, get the
older
cookbook,
man.
Go see this guy wherever he is. Maybe he'll
really?
Come to your house.
Whoa.
Maybe he'll come to your house and cook for you if you're lucky.
Yep. Invite us. That's what we're doing. We're going around the country cooking for people, so...
Hashtag Fred White and Blue.
Hashtag Fred White and Blue. Me and the missus, show the missus sitting over there.
Right there. Hello.
Email her.
Email her.
FedWhiteAndBlue@gmail.com And maybe we'll come and cook for you.
Cheers.
If you don't behave yourself. Cheers.